Bring your guilt and bring your pain. Don't you know that's not your name? Oh, you'll always be much more to me. And every day I wrestle with the voices that keep telling me I'm not right, but I'm all right. 'Cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, and greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world. In the bring your hurt and bring your tears. There'll be no condemnation here. Oh, you are holy, righteous, and redeemed. And every day I fall, there'll be those who will call me a mistake. Well, that's okay, 'cause I hear a voice and he calls me redeemed. When others say I'll never be enough, and greater is the one living inside of me than he who is living in the world. In the world.
And thank
you
God loves us, and in response, God asks us to love the world. God is gracious to us, and in response, God asks us to live grateful lives. That sounds simple, but it is so hard, knowing that we have messed up and that God loves us anyway. Let us confess our sins together. We will all take a moment of silent confession. God,
you fill our lives with chances to love, and you give us the voice to sing your joyful praise. Forgive us.
God's love will carry us wherever we go, from here, and we will never run out of opportunities to try again.
In the love of Christ, we are forgiven, and we will try again.
And thunder in his fist, our God is an awesome God. And the Lord, he wasn't joking when he kicked him out of Eden. It wasn't for no reason that he shed his blood. His return is very soon, so you better be believing that our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above.
I'd invite any kids to come on up, or if you're feeling young or immature, we'll take it all. You're welcome to come up. Well, good morning. How are you all this morning? You guys are doing a great job. Excellent. That's all right. I've forgotten old prayers and gone past them in services. We keep moving. So, when I say the word joy, what do you think about?
Jumping up and down.
You ever been so excited you've jumped up and down for joy?
Yes.
Yeah? You're so excited you grab a pillow and headbutt the pillow 1,000 times. And scream into the pillow. Get that excited. What are some reasons you get so excited? Get a new dog? That's pretty exciting. You're in a play? That's pretty exciting. What else? Any other things pop into mind? Sleep? You get that excited about going to sleep? All right. So when the band director praises you for doing something in marching band, because that rarely ever happens. Pretty much never. Yeah, sometimes we just get so excited we can't contain ourselves. That is joy. Joy is something within us that we have all the time. And it changes how we look at things and how we experience things. And we're going to hear a story today about joy. And then we're going to close with prayer. So Jennifer's going to read a story about joy. You can sit if you want. Your choice.
This is The Little Book of Joy by His Holiness the Dalai Lama and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. One of us grew up in a little house. One of us grew up in a big house. Our houses were on opposite sides of the world. One way over here, and then one way down here. Often we were sad and lonely. Both of us wished for a friend. Sometimes the other kids would want us to play. When they were very far away, we wondered if we would always be sad and lonely. But when we sat still and breathed in the quiet, we noticed something beautiful. If you just focus on the thing that is making you sad, then the sadness is all you see. But when you look around, you will see that joy is everywhere. Joy is the warm food you feel in us, the sun tingling your toes in the morning. It's the giggly, squiggly feeling you are when you're doing something silly. And it's the soft, snuggly feeling of being all wrapped up, cozy in bed at night. Even when you're caught in the rain and the joy is washed away, it's waiting at the bottom of the puddle. Even if you spray on the door and the joy can't get in, it's just on the other side waiting for you to love the puddle. And even if it's a loud noise in the night and your joy gets scared away, it comes streaming right back with the light of the silver moon. We discovered that the more joy we shared, the more joy we had. And the more joy we had, the more joy we could share. So look for joy all around you and share it. Write your little letter. Play it on the drum. Sing it to the sky. It will travel up in the air, across the ocean. Someone will find it and share it. And it strikes from person to person. The world will be filled with joy.
Let's say a prayer together before you head back. Everyone can repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for joy and those things inside us that we can't contain. Help us to spread joy wherever we go. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
Two at Montreat. We have six high school conferences throughout the summer. Well, 6, 7, or 8. The week we went with 900 high schoolers. This year, I also have a small group leader. So with 33 other small group leaders, they invited 900 kids among us. For a small group in the morning and in the afternoon. So I have a group of 18 students. And then a group of 12 students. We meet in the morning and the afternoon. Everyone here is also in a small group, but with different leaders. And make sure you're not with anyone that you know. Which could be kind of intimidating, but it's always good. It's always a good job. So the theme this year was enjoy, as it says on my shirt. Some of the topics for the week was, God is the source of our joy. And we are the source of God's joy. Joy is not a destination, it's a practice. Joy is not a solo act. Joy is an act of defiance. The world needs a joy. So we filled out a little questionnaire for each of us. I'm going to share what we thought of the week. What is one thing you learned about on this trip? And the difference between joy and happiness. And so it didn't time to, but there's a difference. Being happy depends on circumstances, things that are going right. And joy not to be chosen in the face of challenging circumstances. I basically just put we are all God's children, all of us. There's not one person that isn't.
Okay, I promise I have not seen topic for Sunday, but I was reminded something I thought about in connection with each other that about resurrection will be more Christianity. And I think part of that is Christmas. Number two, when did you see God at work in the Spirit? Same as I got every day, all the time. But particularly with all the youth and also with them supporting each other in this music.
I wrote when I was in the sunset, there was a sunset. I put when everyone was supportive, whatever you shared in small groups. Everyone was so accepting, there was no judgment, and it's just really supportive and good environment. I have seen 900 plus high schoolers singing, laughing, and praying together each morning and evening.
and it was quite exciting to look around and see all of the joy and happiness and the acceptance everyone felt among each other. Share one thing you found meaningful during worship, devotional, or small groups. There are always things that make it hard to rejoice. We need to remember that we belong to God and not our pain. In keynote, which is the morning service, I put the cake clapping video. So there was this video of this little kid who, it was preschool activity, and they would clap. And after everyone was clapping, he would just burst out laughing. And he would just continue to laugh. There was no other kid laughing. But his giggle was so adorable. We were all laughing. And then Jennifer found him on Facebook later. It's amazing. So great.
I put the mayor in our phone so I say
and I put them on the wall. It was hard to pick, but I was reminded that we talked about rest on Sabbath rest. Doesn't have to be Sunday, there's supposed to be some time. And there are 7 types of rest. Physical, social, mental, creative, sensory, spiritual, and emotional. And we need to remember all 7 types of rest. We've got the rules of the 7 types of rest. Design new things for someone 30s, which was my favorite. Who's got a book?
So my first day for my small group, we ended up inside the small group going into 3 different small groups. And the activity was to make some things out of your own town and make a whole new town with the other people in your small group. And we were supposed to come up with a name for your town. And ours, the name of our town was very amazing. It's called Downtown. One of my favorite reading was in the small group that I had. We shared about joy that was lost during COVID. Some of the favorite things that we missed out on. But then we also care about unexpected joys on the moment. Even though there was something, it was something we all experienced together, we all lost something, but we also found something that time. What is the funniest moment on this trip? Which is shareable. At the time it wasn't funny, but I put, when we got to our rental, we couldn't get in. And this happened last year also. And the number I called was not the right number for the host. But I think Josh figured it out. There were, for the second year in a row. There were three different doors with phones on it, and the very last one we tried. That.
Oh, yeah.
Well, she didn't bring anything, but she passed through a window.
I shared with one of my friends that I had made in my small group. There's when there's the speed limit signs, but then it counts the numbers or whatever at how fast you're going. So he ran, I got the news of it, but he ran down the street and his goal was to get 20 miles per hour and he got 18, surprisingly, and I just think that was how far he was stopping him, how high up going there, but it was pretty impressive. I thought that was hilarious.
I put big happy
I found it really kind of funny that Rachel got cast to let the process be reviewed. We both thought she was in the front part. Very bad. Unfortunately, she called me all she's old enough. She got from that together eventually. Our favorite memory of this trip in general? One of my favorite memories is finding the mystery.
Oh, yeah, they are memories we're either going to sleep or they will have energized that we didn't know.
Mine was spending time at the back home group, and after being with a small group all day, we would do some activities at the house, we would go out, and just like having dinner with each other was really bonding. We had a lot of fun making bracelets or just doing other fun activities together. In general, my favorite kind of keynote worship and father. So all the groups throughout the day. And we had dinner together in the back home group because we wouldn't see each other often throughout the day. We could discuss how our days went, we shared with each other, but like, in small groups. How did this trip impact your faith? It gave me hope for the future. And wanting to find more youth to experience Montreat. It's an experience you can't put in words. So we create like core memories in this group. I just said it helped me grow as a Christian. I found that since this is my second year, it's not the same. So next year is going to be much better too, because they don't have the same leaders for like keynotes. Night worship or the music, but it definitely helped me grow as a Christian.
I put it makes me want to go to meet
you. It's a reminder that I matter and we each matter to God every single day, every day. I want to trip in past my mother at home. I'm going to try harder to choose joy instead of happiness. I'm going to try harder to choose joy every single day.
Being able to focus more on the positive and try to like forgive people easier instead of trying to hold a grudge and just forget. As being a small group leader this year, I found more resources and learning to incorporate into youth group for the kids. And as we changed from having two youth groups this year, grades 5 through 7, grades 8 through 12, that will help me. Anything extra you'd like to share? I wrote down 3 comments. The last thing Jesus wants our disciples to stay in a locked room. Our God sees the possibilities in us we can't see in ourselves. We need to keep the church outside of the building walls because we will make a difference out in our communities and on the world. Well, first of all, on one of the days when I was in my connecting group, which is our fun games group after like whatever, and there was this giant spider on the door frame. It was about this big, and so we all screamed, pretty much all of us, a couple of them wanted to go get the shoe, and then we screamed at them not to because they might jump at us. And so we exited out of the other door, and then some people did come get it after that. I also, we learned some Korean, and I actually only wrote down one of them, but Jung, meaning strong affection, love, passion, and compassion. God rarely forces us to respond, he'll sit and wait. God's Jung is sticky and is starting to unravel our And I wrote a bunch of other stuff down and stuff. Being older and thoughts of being older, I'm not going to share all of that because that would be like probably
older. I miss my small group, brothers. And I'm going to say, so I looked up the brothers.
Awesome experience. And I want to thank all of you for your support, for your prayers, for everything that you do. It makes a difference. Thank you.
second gospel reading this morning is from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 24 through 31. Jesus appears to Thomas and the disciples. Thomas, the one called Didymus, one of the 12, wasn't with the disciples when Jesus came. Another of the disciples told him, "We've seen the Lord." But he replied, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, put my finger in the wounds left by the nails, and put my hands into his side, I won't believe." After 8 days, his disciples were again in a house, and Thomas was with them. Even though the doors were locked, Jesus entered and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look at my hands. Put your hand into my side. No more disbelief. Believe." Thomas responded to Jesus, "My Lord and my God." Jesus replied, "Do you believe because you have seen me? Happy are those who don't see and yet believe." Then Jesus did many other miraculous signs in his disciples' presence. Signs that aren't recorded in the scrolls. But those things are written so that you will believe that Jesus is the Christ, God's Son, and that believing, you will have life in his name.
So it's a full service, so we'll kind of introduce the topic, and then I think the plan will be we'll continue the discussion Wednesday night at dinner church. So if you want to keep talking about this question, we'll keep talking on Wednesday. I did forget to announce one thing. In 2 weeks, we'll be at Gunn Park. So we won't be here. We'll be at Gunn Park for worship. Just a reminder about that. So the original question posed for this Sunday, sometimes I'll kind of expand the scope of a question, but the original question was, can I still be a Christian if I doubt the virgin birth? That's the question that was submitted. And I've expanded it to ask the question, what do you have to believe to be a Christian? Like, where's the threshold? Where's the line that you hit? So let's start here. How do you define a Christian? What do you think? You believe in Jesus as your Savior, okay? Anyone else want to throw a definition out of a Christian?
A follower
of Christ. Anything else? So believing that Christ is God's Son. Okay, that they are one. Okay. Niels. Loving one another makes you a Christian. Okay. Anyone else?
Actually, the principles taught by Jesus in the parables.
Acting on the principles taught by Jesus in the parables. So putting Jesus' teachings and the parables into practice. Okay. So depending on who you ask and what, from what tradition in Christianity, you're going to get very different answers to this question. What do you have to believe to be a Christian, and what is a Christian? In our tradition, we encompass kind of other traditions too. Our governing principles are two parts. The first part is called the Book of Confessions. That's this. You've probably never opened it. I'm not judging. I'm just observing. It's a record of historical documents worked out by councils of the church over the years to try to answer these questions. What does it mean to have faith? What does it mean to follow Jesus? What does it mean to be a Christian? What does it mean to be the church? All of these kinds of questions have gotten different answers over the years. It goes all the way back to the first creeds. The Nicene Creed, the Apostles' Creed, which we don't say a lot, but I grew up in the ELCA church, so we said one of those every week. The week without communion, we said the Apostles' Creed. The week with communion, we said the Nicene Creed. And it's a breakdown of, you know, these are the things we agree upon that we believe in. Now, there's never been complete consensus on those things throughout time, and we're still wrestling with them. But as I grew up, within this question, I think is almost a false assumption. Being a Christian is all about belief, right? We always ask the question, what do you have to believe to be a Christian? So it's all about the things we believe. And depending on who you ask that question, they're going to have different parameters, the things you have to believe in to be a Christian. There are people within certain streams of Christianity that will not view me as a Christian because I've never spoken in tongues. And for them, that's a criteria to be a Christian. You have to speak in tongues. I tried to pitch that I had to learn Greek and Hebrew, and I took French in college, but that didn't count. That's not what they're talking about. In our two readings this morning, the parable of the sheep and goats, what is the criteria for how they're judged? Behavior. How you treated the least of these, the poor, the hungry, the imprisoned, the sick, the marginalized, how you treated that group determined if you were a sheep or a goat. In that context, sheep are good, goats are bad. The parable of the sheep and goats doesn't mention belief. It's not a part of the criteria. It's an interesting parable. The other one, doubting Thomas. Poor Thomas, forever doubting. How does Jesus respond to Thomas's doubt? Remember, Thomas, they came to Thomas and said, "We've seen the Lord." How does Thomas reply? "Unless I put my finger in the nail marks, I won't believe it." How did Jesus respond to Thomas? He provided what he needed to believe. He showed up and he said, "Thomas, put your hands here, put your fingers here, put your hand here." And he said, "You believe because you see, but blessed are those who believe and don't see." What we like as humans is an either or. We're way more comfortable with an either or. It's either this or it's that. We like strong boundaries between those two. One is right, one is wrong. We don't like messiness. The Bible's not that simple. It's not all about belief. It's not also all about what we do. Both seem to matter. We like to say that different parts of the Bible, you know, James is disagreeing with Paul because James emphasizes the works we do matter most because they show our faith, and Paul says, no, no, no. We can do nothing apart from the grace God gives us. It's grace alone. Well, read the fullness of both, and they don't disagree nearly that much. It's both. Now, here's the problem I see in how we handle this. We try to be the gatekeepers of what it means to be a Christian. We try to set the parameters with what we're comfortable with for people being a Christian. You have to check these boxes of belief, and when you check all of the boxes of belief, you are then a Christian by our judgment. What does that turn us into? What role are we playing in the Bible when we do that? Who were the great judges? Pharisees. Turns us into the Pharisees. The Pharisees had it all figured out. They knew what it meant to follow the law and live an appropriate, righteous Jewish life. They determined the boxes you had to check and the life you had to live to be righteous. And none were more righteous than they were. For all of the interactions with Jesus and the Pharisees, boy, do we spend a lot of time trying to be Pharisees. You think we'd learn? So we'll talk more Wednesday about, are there things that need to be there to be called a Christian? Are there a certain minimum beliefs that have to be there? Or do we really need to rethink what that means? So this is an intro. Come Wednesday, we'll continue this discussion. We'll sing our next hymn. It's in your purple hymnal, number 729, Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. For our joys and concerns today, prayers for Candy as she has surgery tomorrow morning, for the Tally son-in-law, Vaughn, who is in hospice care, for Linda and Steve's daughter, Lydia, who's hospitalized with pregnancy complications. Keep her in your prayers. Also, there's a joy. Judy and Ron Nesvold welcome their first great-grandchild, a little girl, so If you were there Wednesday night, we're all wondering. But they're both healthy and home, so congratulations to them. Emily's going to lead us in our prayers.
God, we give thanks for the ways we experience your presence through the people in our lives, for friends who know us through and through, for families or mentors who embody your care, for church communities who love us for who we are, for the assurance we should love ourselves.
As we give thanks, God, we also remember the blessings of our lives, where faith comes rather than love, where goodness gives way to brokenness, where we can feel the hurt of everything around us. We pray for resilience and forgiveness for nature creatures, for compassion and changes for all of us who call to care for your creation. We pray for people who are ill, who are grieving, or who are lost, or who are certain that they are alone. Empower us to embody your love for them and enlighten us to know your love for us. We pray for people and communities who are suffering, people affected by violence or war, racism, sexism, transphobia, or any fear that disguises itself as hatred. For people struggling with mental illness and people who enjoy feels unattainable. Help them, help us, and help us to help each other. We join our voices now with all the disciples of every time and every place, saying the prayer that Jesus taught us. Eternal Spirit, earth maker, creator, life giver, source of all that is and shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God, in whom we serve. The hallowed be your name, hallowed be the universe. The way of your justice, the power of the evils of the world. Your heavenly will be done by all created beings. Your common love, peace, and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we need for today, give us. The hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trials too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. For you reign in glory, power, and love, now and forever. Amen.
Friends, one of the ways we can cultivate joy in our lives is by practicing generosity. God calls us to share our gifts for God's work in the world and to receive the joy that comes from giving. Let us joyfully offer our gifts to God. We bring our offering.
I know you are near.
Let us pray. God, we return to you what you entrust to us. May it be used to the work of your kingdom in this world, spreading your message of hope, of love, of peace, and of joy. May we be ambassadors of that message. It is through Christ that we pray. Amen. We'll sing our final hymn, number 80, You Shall Go Out with Joy.
Shall go out with joy and be my forth with peace. The mountains and the hills will break forth before you. There'll be shouts of joy, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. And all the trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field will clap their hands. The trees of the field.
And all God's people joyfully said,
Amen.
Share the peace of Christ with one another. Good job.